I'm Paul Van Squyke, your Taekwondo guide, and this is Topic Tuesday. If you're new around here, don't turn this off. Don't turn it off. Listen, learn about what Topic Tuesday actually is. It's really simple. People write in questions, and we talk about them. They just leave them in the comments below. And it's a great way to have a conversation about Taekwondo. This isn't the kind of video that you sit around and watch. So put your headphones in, listen, and get some stuff done around the house. It's a good way to learn while you get stuff done. All right, our first topic comes from Daryl, who wants to know more about the original Taekwondo Kwans. Daryl says, from what I read, there were 5 original and 4 more after the Korean War. Although, did the techniques vary much between them? When did the WT fighting style emerge, and by whom or which one? Why did they change it from the traditional style? A deep dive mystery. Did they mention this much in Tang Soo Do? Oh, this is a deep question, Daryl, like you said. I do go into this quite a bit in my video called The Evolution of Taekwondo Kicks, which is probably the most difficult video I've ever made for the channel. So if you haven't checked it out, I'd love you to see that one. It was a lot of work I put into that to dig into these very things, complete with a lot of historical video footage. Now, Daryl, my understanding is that there were 7 original Kwans, just like the 7 rings for the Dwarf Lords. We can remember 7. That's one of those sacred numbers that pops up all the time, right? 7 original Kwans, that sounds good. I printed a list of them because I can't remember them all by name. So let me go through this real quickly. We have the Chengdo Kwan, the Mudok Kwan, the Song Mu Kwan, the Yun Mu Kwan, the Cheng Mu Kwan, the Han Mu Kwan, and the Odo Kwan, and a note on the Yun Mu Kwan. That's also known as the Jido Kwan, I think more commonly. Now, almost all of these people, these Kwan founders, were influenced directly by Shotokan Karate. Some of them trained directly under Funakoshi. There's a few that are a little unusual, such as the Mudok Kwan, which was founded by Huang He. And that's actually the branch that I come from. My head instructor came directly out of that school in Korea. He is now 84 years old. And that is why I have a red stripe in the middle of my black belt, because it is a Mudok Kwan style Tang Soo Do black belt. And the reason I mention him as being a little different is where exactly he learned is up for debate. He claims to have studied Taekyon as a child. This is Huang He, the founder of the Mudok Kwan, who's no longer with us, so we can't ask him. And then to have learned some Chinese martial arts when stationed, I think, on a railway in Manchuria, something like that. And then learning the Shotokan forms from books, and I'm sure training with other individuals, and synthesizing this all together into this thing called the Mudok Kwan. So a little bit different background, and you can see the way they moved originally is it's its own thing. It's got a different kind of movement system than the styles that came right out of Shotokan Karate. At least that's my opinion on the matter. So, what's your first question about the Kwans? Did the techniques vary much between them? Well, all of the techniques were very similar to what you would have seen in karate at the time. But there was enough variety that the Korean government didn't like it. They thought the Kwans should unify because they were all about the Korean nationalism at the time, and they wanted unified product to present to the world. They didn't want all these people doing their own things. Now, even though many of them at least, learned the Shotokan system, you guys know how it goes. You learn martial arts and you kind of start doing your own thing. You make tweaks here and there. If you read the book, A Killing Art, one of the things that the author says about General Choi is that he made this radical innovation with a low block, and instead of pretty much straightening the arm, he had the arm bent with the low block. And so that was one of his radical changes. And then, of course, eventually added in this whole sine wave movement system where the performers bounce up and down when performing their hyung or form. I'm not sure what they call it in ITF. So there were some differences, certainly. But at its core, everyone was pretty much doing karate with minor differences. When did the WT fighting style emerge and by whom or which one? Well, there's a lot of people involved in this, but I'm gonna create a monolithic entity that we can point a finger at and say the Korean government, the Park regime. They're the ones who took over in a military coup. I think it was 1961. They took over South Korea. And they're the ones who were big on the Korean nationalism thing, and they're the ones who wanted the unification of the Kwans and the techniques, and they wanted it standardized in a similar way, I think, to what happened to Wushu in China under the communist regimes, where they merged it together and created this state sort of sponsored thing called Wushu. I'm hazy on the details on that, but I think it's kind of comparable. So, if you're wondering who created the WT, it was first the first organization to emerge was the Korean Taekwondo Association, the KTA, and that was the group that kind of unified the Kwans. And a lot of them pushed back and resisted, but only two did not unify. Eventually, they all fell into line. Maybe not the original founders, but the organizations over time all merged into what we all think of Taekwondo today, modern WT Taekwondo, that is. The two that did not go in, Hwang Hee with the Murak Kwan, he wanted to keep his own thing, Subakdo, Tang Sudo, and I think there were some court battles there, if I'm not mistaken. And then General Choi's Kwan, which was the Odo Kwan, and of course that merged into his thing, became the ITF version of Taekwondo. So he didn't fall into line with that. Now, in 71, I want to say it was, 1971, that's when the WTF, now the WT, emerged. And they were sort of seen as an oversight group to promote sport Taekwondo. So they're the ones who crafted what we would call Olympic sparring, this specific rule set. It's changed over the years, but what we think of as Taekwondo sparring, that emerged from the WTF sometime around the early 70s. And that was the result of the unification of all of these Kwans together. This is also the time that the Taeguk Pumse emerged. Prior to, everyone was doing their own thing. They tried to unify the forms together originally in the 60s with the Palgwe forms, but they were finding too many variations of how schools were teaching it. They didn't think they were great for modern audiences. They were supposedly more based around Chinese influences, so they wanted a more Korean art to present to the world and something that would be better for competitive purposes, and thus the Taeguk Pumse were formed, and that's of course what we all practice today if we're under the WT system. Now, everyone kind of did their own thing to some extent or another. My instructor, who I mentioned earlier, he's always maintained the Tang Sudo origin of his training, so we've always learned that component. And he basically just added the WT Taekwondo to it. So we've always learned the concoction of the two things, which he calls Musudo, the Musudo system. And he also incorporated Hapkido into that. So that's how I learned. And I imagine a lot of other instructors kind of did similar things. They kept elements of the original Kwan they came from, but wanted to be part of the energy of the new unified Taekwondo. It's a understandable why you would want to be part of that. Makes it easy to go and compete and to network with other dojangs and be part of something that is in fact unified. So I can understand that. All right, let's see if you have anything else about the Kwans. I think I covered when they changed it from the traditional style. It was an evolution that took place in the 60s and 70s. So you could say that all of these schools were practicing Tangsudo back in the day. So Tangsudo is the Korean way of saying karate if you're using the Okinawan characters. So karate would have originally been written, the Tang, that part represents the Chinese dynasty, Tang dynasty, and it actually means something like belligerent soldiers or rude soldiers. It is referencing the soldiers of that era, but it basically means China, right? So the first character means China. Second character is hand. And if you add the do suffix, you'd have the way of the Chinese hand. So this is what like Funakoshi would have originally called karate. It's said the same way. He changed the suffix, the first character, and changed it to empty hand or way of the empty hand. You still again pronounce that character the same way you would Chinese hand. So it, in the same way that Korea was trying to nationalize their martial arts, he felt that this was more appealing to a Japanese audience if you didn't reference China, because nationalism was the name of the game at the time, and they didn't want the reference to China inside of a martial art that was trying to be promoted as a Japanese martial art. So, Tangsudo is just the way the Koreans said karate. And the name Taekwondo, I think it was agreed on in something like 1965, 1966, somewhere in there. They've batted around a bunch of different names. But you could say that all of these Kwans were at some point or another practicing Tangsudo. So yes, they mention it in Tangsudo. Tangsudo is a history of Taekwondo. Pretty much all Taekwondo comes from what you could call Tangsudo. I hope that makes sense. All right, next question comes from Mike and Lisa Banjo, Fiddle 8280, who says, in reference to another Topic Tuesday video, another great video, question. I have read and heard, mostly older, Taekwondo masters say if you're not planning on teaching Taekwondo, there is no need to achieve a master level, fourth dan and higher. What are your thoughts on this? I have known some people who got first dan and never tested again, but are some of the best martial artists I've ever encountered. Thanks. Yeah. So as we know, rank is not an indicator of skill. All it can really do is indicate how long you have been in the martial arts. Now, some schools may hold each rank to an extremely high standard, in which case you can judge from that particular school that a high rank is a very high skill level. But because there's no standardization in that, from school to school, we have no idea what fourth dan means in terms of skill. So all we can really say is a fourth dan has probably been around for quite a while. If you follow the Kukyuan testing guidelines, so if we're talking Kukyuan Taekwondo, there are minimum times you must complete or wait between dan levels. So there's only so, how shall I say this? There's a minimum amount of time that someone would need to have practiced to be a fourth dan, for example. Okay, so we know it means that they've put time in. We know it's not related to skill. You don't need to be a fourth dan for anything. Does it help as an instructor? I think it's helpful to, if you don't know a lot of about martial arts, your dan rank can sound impressive to people. And I don't mean to belittle it. If you're a high-ranking black belt, it absolutely means you've put a lot of time, and thus almost certainly a lot of hard work, into your training. One of the Olympic coaches, I'm sure, is a black belt. I have never seen him wearing a black belt, and I don't have any idea what his rank is. He could be a first-degree black belt, for all I know. A highly talented practitioner and instructor, right there. I have no idea what rank they are. So it really, I think, depends on the kind of school you want to have, first of all, because if you're really heavily keyed into sparring, there's no connection between needing a certain rank and being able to teach sparring. Outside of black belt, you need that Kukyoan black belt certificate to participate in certain events. But outside of that, it doesn't really seem to matter much. So, it's interesting, right? Because in the medical profession, for example, if you want to treat people, you need certain diplomas. Well, that's not the case for martial arts. If you want to teach people, you don't need to have any particular rank. And if you didn't tell people what you were, in theory, they would never need to know. But I do think from the standpoint of just being able to list credentials and build trust with people, having a high-ranking black belt does look good, and it is an indicator that you've been around for a while. So if you were interested in being a school owner or in, if you are a school owner, I like to have higher ranking instructors. I don't want to keep people at a low black belt level if they're teaching. I want them to move up the belt ranks because of the appearance that it has to particularly newer members who don't understand the martial arts and need some reason to say, oh, this person is qualified. They're going to look for reasons they can wrap their head around, and one of those reasons is your rank. Okay. From CVS 33. In one of your Taekwondo Guide videos, you mentioned Taekwondo saved my life. Yes, that is the name of one of my videos, which you can go watch. Can you elaborate more? The physical fitness benefits you experienced from martial arts growing up. Sure, learning martial arts techniques along with self-discipline and respect are important. How can families encourage our youth to be more involved in some kind of physical fitness training? Yeah, good question. So, specifically on the fitness side, I was really thinking about this and I'm trying to decide what makes Taekwondo and many of the other martial arts special from a fitness standpoint. Obviously, if we go lift weights at the gym, we get big and strong, we get good at moving heavy objects. So what does Taekwondo from a fitness standpoint make us good at? Well, first, it's incredibly rounded. When you're hitting targets, when you're sparring, when you're doing pumse at full intensity, it's a good cardiovascular workout. You're getting your heart pumping, no doubt about that. The most tired I've ever been in any type of exercise is in Taekwondo training. If you don't believe me, spar and spar and spar and spar, you will get exhausted. Or keep hitting a heavy bag over and over and over, you will get exhausted. Further, you do need a fair bit of strength to be able to perform a lot of the kicks. You simply can't do the kicks well if you lack the core strength and the hip strength to get your leg to move into those positions. you've got to have way stronger than average hip and core strength to do those things. And flexibility. You've got to have way higher than average flexibility to be able to do a lot of the Taekwondo techniques correctly. So it's quite well-rounded. There's not a lot of fitness programs that key into those three areas so thoroughly. But what does that really amount to? And what I would say is Taekwondo makes you an incredibly good mover. That's what you're adapting your body to, ultimately, is to be able to move incredibly dynamically and beautifully. It's almost like a lethal, poetic movement. You can see that in a lot of combat sport athletes. There's a fluidity, a beauty to their movements, a poetry to their movements, and yet a lethality to it. You know how dangerous the movement is. Whether it be a kick you absolutely don't want to get hit with, a throw that you feel like would shatter your bones. Watch a wrestler do a single or double leg takedown, the way they flow down to the ground or weave around their opponent. Beautiful movements when taken to a high level. So Taekwondo, Karate, a lot of these type of martial arts, I think the fitness element, when put together, makes you an expert mover in ways that most people have little understanding of. And sure, some take it to an even higher level, like wushu or capoeira, where it's even more extreme athleticism behind your movement. But even just for general motions, I think Taekwondo really helps develop the way that you move in a way that you don't see in many other things. The only other things you could compare it to would be like gymnastics, dance, highly disciplined dance like ballet. And the difference is that your movements, when coordinated in the form of a martial art, have a lethality to them, which is cool, right? That's a lot of fun. So you're honing your body to be expert level at moving in a way that could be potentially lethal. That's what I would say is special about the fitness gained from Taekwondo and similar arts like karate. The other part of the question is, how can families encourage our youth to be more involved in some kind of physical fitness training? Well, the first thing to say to that is lead from the front. If you as a parent are not engaged in a physical culture of some kind, then there's no reason you can expect your child to do something that you're not willing to do yourself. So you must be a good role model for your children. Show them good habits when it comes to eating, when it comes to rest, and when it comes to participating in some kind of physical culture so you gain the benefits, the physical benefits. I would also use I'd point this out. Nobody would think it's acceptable to not send their child to school. Nobody would say, you know, it's okay if you don't learn to read or write. I think that physical fitness, building a basis for a comfort in your own body and physical health, is just as critical as the skills that we want kids to learn at school. And so to me, it's wild that you would say you must commit to reading and writing, but you don't need to learn anything about physical fitness. And the reason for that is that there's not really a separation between the mind and body. The better your physical health, the better your mind functions. We know this now. This has been demonstrated over and over again in every study ever. If you want to improve not only the ability of your mind in terms of your ability to focus, but the way in which the quality of life you live from the standpoint of your mindset, your mental health, you need to be involved in some kind of physical activity, even if it's just taking a walk. So I think parents should really work toward finding something that their children can at least tolerate that is physical activity. It doesn't need to be severe. It can literally just be going for a walk every day for a few miles. Something, though, that gets you up and moving around and using your body. That needs to be just as important to raising a child as teaching them to read and write, in my opinion. Otherwise, you're setting them up for bad mental health and not giving them all that they need to be a successful individual. So just making that part of the family culture, I think, is critical. And the nice thing is there's so many ways to exercise that it's pretty likely that you'll find something that they can at least tolerate, that they're willing to do. And a lot of times you can disguise exercise. Do they like taking pictures of things? Maybe they like taking photos of birds, okay? Well, if you go for hikes so that you can take photos of birds, there is your physical activity. It doesn't have to be CrossFit or Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu or something extreme like that. It can be something as simple as going for a hike to see if you can take some cool photos of a bird. But it needs to be emphasized as part of the family culture. Well, guys, that wraps up our Topic Tuesday for this week. You know the drill. Get down in those comments and leave some questions so that we can have a stellar Topic Tuesday next week. You know what, guys? I so appreciate you taking your time to listen to these things. It's really amazing to me that everyone gets together. It's a lot of fun. And don't forget to check out my website, tkdguide.com, which has some free courses for you that help you improve your Taekwondo. Until next time, enjoy your training.